In the last lecture, I told you how to solve the swing equation by the step-by-step method. In this lecture, we will see the application of Runge-Kutta method for the solution of swing equation. So what is Runge-Kutta method? It's a standard numerical method for the solution of differential equations. See, whenever we have nonlinear equations, we resort to numerical methods. Essentially, in any numerical method, you have to know the initial condition, and from the initial condition, using an algorithm, we move forward in time. Most of these differential equations are with respect to time. The independent variable is the time. So from the initial condition, I calculate what is the variable, the dependent variable in the next time step, and so on, we move forward. This is what, in general, any numerical method has to offer. Now, Runge-Kutta method, they are a class of methods where the changes in the dependent variables are calculated from a given set of formulae, and these are approximations of the Taylor's series expansion for the differential equation. So let us consider first a general set of equations and then project it onwards to our swing equation. So if you consider two differential equations in x and y, so let us assume dx by dt is given by a function f of x, which is a function of x, y and t, and dy by dt is a function fy of x, y and t. This is general because t is also considered as one of the factors. Now, first we will take up second order Runge-Kutta method. Here, the updation is as follows. X1, that is the variable x at the next time step is equal to x0. X0 is the variable at the current time step plus k1 plus k2 by 2. So k1 and k2 are coefficients which we will calculate. I will tell you shortly. Similarly, the updation of y1 is based on the knowledge of y0, which is the value of y in the current time step, plus h1 plus h2 by 2. So this k1, k2, h1, h2 are simply the names of the coefficients. I have just used what people commonly use. You can use any other nomenclature too. So x1 and y1 are values in the current time step and x0 and y0 in the previous time step, or you can take x0 and y0 in the current time step and x1 and y1 in the next time step, either way. So k1, k2, h1, h2 are defined as follows. Let us assume I start with the initial variables as x0 and y0 at time t0. Okay, so this has to be known. I calculate this from the system conditions, whatever it is. And let's take a time step of delta t seconds. So if I assume t naught is 0, that means starting at time 0, then my next variables I'm calculating at t plus t naught plus delta t. And after that, t naught plus 2 delta t and so on. So at every step, I progress by a time of delta t seconds. So k1, k2, h1, h2 are defined as follows. K1 is equal to f of x, x0, y0, star delta t. That means you evaluate the function f of x using the initial values x0 and y0 and compute k1. Similarly, h1 is obtained as f of x0, y0, star delta t. So what we do to calculate k1 and h1 is I use the initial values of x0, y0 and calculate the values of k1 and h1. Once I calculate k1 and h1, k2 is defined as f of x. So x0 is updated by k1. So the function f of x is evaluated with the value of x as x0 plus k1 and the value of y as y0 plus h1. Similarly, I update h2 also. I calculate h2. Okay, so using the initial values, I can find out the coefficients k1, k2, h1 and h. Once I know them, I calculate the updated values of x1 and y1. That is, if I assume x0 and y0 are at a time step t0, x1 and y1 are at a time step of t0 plus delta t. So I calculate it as x0 plus k1 plus k2 by 2 and y1 is equal to y0 plus h1 plus h2 by 2. So now I have the values of x and y at a time t0 plus delta t. Right? Now I use the values of x1, y1 here to calculate the value of x and y at the next time step. That is t0 plus 2 delta t. So what do I do for that? I let this x1, what I have calculated now, that I will equate it to x0. That is, it will become the new variable. And y1 will be equal to y0. And again, using these values of x0 and y0, I calculate f1, h1, k2, h2, and then go about iteration after iteration. Clear? So let me just summarize. You start with x0 and y0. Use that values of x0 and y0 to calculate k1, k2, h1, h2. Then calculate x1, which will give you the value at the new time interval, that is t plus delta t. Right? And once you know x1 and y1, use this to calculate x2, y2. And use x2, y2 to calculate x3, y3. So each one is a subsequent value at the next time step. Simple. Now, if you want to solve the swing equation, I have given you the values, the equations for the general differential equation. So this is my swing equation. Md squared delta by dt squared is equal to the accelerating power, pa, which is equal to Pm, that is the mechanical power, minus Pmax sine delta. So Pmax sine delta is the electrical power output. So the acceleration of the generator is equal to accelerating power is equal to the input mechanical power minus the output electrical power. Right? So this is a second order differential equation. I write it as two first order differential equations. For that, I rewrite this equation as d squared delta by dt squared is equal to Pa by m, and m in per unit, if you're calculating in degree electrical, is h by 180 f, or if you're doing it in second square per radian, it is h by pi f. Okay? And H is unique to the machine. Every machine will have H, which is megajoules per MVA. Now, I write this equation, d squared delta by dt squared is equal to Pa by M, as two first order differential equations. They are as follows. So, d delta by dt is equal to omega, right? Where here, omega stands for, as we saw in the step-by-step procedure, it is the deviation from the synchronous speed. It is not the absolute speed. It is the deviation from the synchronous speed, omega L's, because omega S. It is giving you the rate of change of angular displacement, delta. And d omega by dt, which is equal to d squared delta by dt squared, is equal to Pa by M. And Pa is Pm minus Pmax sine delta by m. Right? So now these are my two first order differential equations in delta and omega. So what is my x? If you recollect in the general, I had two variables x and y. So here I can call delta as x and omega as y. So I have dx by dt and dy by dt. And we will be using the same formula we used earlier for the general set of equations. What is it? So we start with initial values of delta naught, omega naught, t naught, and a time step of delta t seconds. So these are calculated, delta naught, omega naught, etc. They are calculated from the known system state. When we do the example, you'll understand how we do it, right? And the two variables, as I told you, are delta and omega. So K1, if you remember, is f of x into delta t. So it is equal to omega naught into delta t. F of x is omega, d delta by dt is omega. So you start with the initial value, which is omega naught. Then h1 is f of y evaluated at x naught and y naught. So it is d omega by dt, that is Pm minus P max. I use the initial value sine delta naught by m into delta t. Clear? Next, what is kt? K2 is omega f of x naught plus k1 and y naught plus h1, right? So k1 is omega naught plus h1, whatever I get, delta t, and h2 is pm minus p max sine delta naught plus k1 by m delta t. Remember, in these equations, omega is y and delta is x. Okay, omega is y and delta is x. So y is updated with y naught plus h1, and x is updated with x naught plus k1. So these are the four coefficients I calculate from the initial value of delta naught and omega naught. So these are the values at time t naught. Next, I update delta and omega as follows. Delta 1 is equal to delta naught plus k1 plus k2 by 2, and omega 1 is equal to omega naught plus h1 plus h2 by 2. Right? So these, what is this delta 1 and omega 1? These are the new values of delta and omega at a time step of t naught plus delta t. Now I use this, okay, and use them as delta naught and omega naught, and again calculate k1, k2, h1, h2. I get the new values of delta 1 and omega 1, which is at the next time step, right? So when you're writing a program, it is actually a loop. I told you at the end of the session, in the end of this module, I will show you the programs, how they are written, okay? So you go on updating as and when you want, for how many ever seconds you want, you go on calculating the values. So this is Runge-Kutta's second order. So the Taylor series has been truncated to second order. So a slightly more accurate is the RK or Runge-Kutta fourth order method. So here the equations used for updation are, I have x1 is equal to x0 plus 1/6. Now I have to calculate four coefficients, k1, k2, k3, and k4. And y1 is equal to y0 plus 1/6 of h1, h2, h3, and h4. Okay, this is Runge-Kutta fourth order. And what are the coefficients? Since you already know second order, you can easily understand. So k1 and h1, I calculate fx and fy using the initial values of x0, y0, and t0. And k2 and h2, I update x0 with x0 plus k1 by 2, y0 as y0 plus h1 by 2, and t0 as t0 plus delta t by 2. So if it's not a function of time, you will not have this term, right? This t0 plus delta t by 2 will not be there. Most often, it'll only be a function of x and y. And similarly, I calculate h2. So this is the order in which you have to calculate the coefficients. Calculate k1 and h1. Use the values of k1 and h1 to calculate k2 and h2. Use these values to calculate k3 and h3, and then k4 and h4. So in each of these, you are computing fx and fi with values of x and y. So starting from x0 and y0, you next update it to x0 plus k1 by 2 and y0 plus h1 by 2, and then to x0 plus k2 by 2 and y0 plus h2 by 2, and then x0 plus k3 and y0 plus h3, right? It is direct substitution and calculating the coefficients. So once I know all these coefficients, I update using the equations we saw. Okay, so now for the swing equation, we already saw the swing equation is written as two first order differential equations. So here the variable x is delta and the variable y is omega. So this is dx by dt, and if you see, it is directly equal to y. Omega is y, and dy by dt is equal to pm minus p max sine of x by m. So if you want to relate these equations to what I showed previously, that's how you do it. And the coefficients are calculated as follows. So first start off with k1 and h1. So k1 is omega naught into delta t, and h1 is pm minus p max sine delta naught by m into delta t. Next, k2 is equal to omega naught. So you have to update x and y with k1 by 2 and h1 by 2. So here k2 is omega naught plus h1 by 2 into delta t. And in h2, in place of delta naught, replace it with delta naught plus k1 by 2. And next, calculate k3. So omega naught plus h2 by 2. And here you replace delta naught with delta naught plus k2 by 2. Next, calculate k4 and h4. So omega naught plus h3, and here delta naught plus k3. So now you have all the coefficients needed, 8 coefficients in this case, and update delta 1 is equal to delta naught plus 1/6 of k1 plus 2k2 plus 2k3 plus k4, and update omega as omega 1 equal to omega naught plus 1/6 of h1 plus 2h2 plus 2h3 plus h4. Clear? So now you have delta and omega at the next time step. Use this to calculate at further the succeeding time step, that is t plus 2 delta t and so on. The only caution you have to keep in mind when you are solving this is, when we use it for solution of the swing equation as we are doing now, we will do it for a stability analysis. Okay. So a stability analysis arises whenever there is a disturbance. Clear? So in the power system, the occurrence of a fault is a disturbance, and the clearing of a fault is also a disturbance. So what would change in these equations? Pm will not change because Pm is the mechanical power input. And when we compute the transient stability, we assume that the mechanical power is a constant throughout the stability assessment. Okay, so Pm is a constant, M is a constant, right? Delta naught is a constant. So it is only P max which would change whenever there is a fault or when a fault is cleared. So in using these equations, you must use the correct value of P max appropriate for that time step. Okay, so whether you are doing it before the occurrence of the fault or during the fault or after the fault is cleared, so you have to use the correct value of P max. Okay, so I will stop this lecture here, and then in the next one, I will show you with an example of how to calculate using Runge-Kutta method. Thank you.